Welcome, everyone. We invite you to stand with us and join us in an old hymn that we sing as an act of putting our trust and our faith in Christ. And I can't quite do it correctly, so I don't.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Welcome again. For those of you who are visiting, we want to extend a special welcome to you. We're excited that you're joining us, those here in person, those on the live stream. We are excited that you're joining us this morning for a time of worship. We want to spend some time this morning and take some time. I'm sure if you've seen the news, you know what's going on in Afghanistan and just the tragedy that's going on there. And so we want to spend some time in prayer as a church together. So I'm going to invite Shar up, and she's going to lead us in a time of prayer for the church in Afghanistan.
Thanks. I don't know if everybody knows, but Afghanistan is the second largest move of the Spirit of God and people coming to know the Lord. There's a great move there. And just recently, with the pullout and everything that has happened, the people there are desperate, and they've asked for prayer. Sean, he's a worship leader in the States. He's called for all the churches, as many churches, to corporately pray, because our God can change things. And just like Saul, before he became Paul, was breathing out murderous threats and pulling out people to kill, and God changed him. There needs to be a change, a protection. The young girls and women are in perilous times right now, all the things, but our God is greater, and he has promised that he is building his church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it, and that our prayers are powerful. So I'll lead, and what you can do is agree in your heart and remember these precious brothers and sisters. For God has told us that we are to remember those who are in chains and to pray for them, just like if that ever happened here, we would not want the world to abandon us. So let's just bow our heads and bring this before the Lord. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you and praise you and worship you. And Father, where right now it looks like the Christians and the people in Afghanistan have been abandoned, you have not abandoned them, God. That you have promised, Lord, that you are faithful, that your word works here in Canada, but it also works in Afghanistan under these terrible, terrible conditions. So we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would come and you would encourage the people, and that you would give them the strength, that their faith does not fail them, that you would even, as you did there for Elisha, that you would blind the eyes of the enemy, O God, that those, that your Christian people would be able to bind together, that you would provide supernaturally for their needs. I pray a protection over the women and the young girls in that country, O God. And I pray, Father, that you would just, Jesus, Holy Spirit, come and encourage these ones. And I thank you that your word and your the move of God will go forth like wildfire in Afghanistan, that there is no devil in hell that can stop what you want to do in Jesus' name. So we're lifting up and expecting victory for that country. And Father, that you can change the hearts of those the Taliban, even right now, that you would give them visions and dreams, God. Father, that you would cut them to the quick, even now. Father, that Afghanistan will be saved, and that you are protecting, God. Wake up your church to pray, Father. Father, for revival, for the harvest that's coming in. God, we just pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Char. Let this not be the only time we pray. Let's continue to lift up Afghanistan and the people there and the church there in our prayers. It's heartbreaking, the stories that are coming out. But again, as Char said, our God is greater, our God is stronger. And so we want to continue worshiping this God this morning, continue lifting up our praises to him as the one who is worthy of our worship. We want to spend some time now in prayer for our loved ones that don't know Christ, our family, friends. Maybe you have connections with people around the world, maybe people in countries where it is illegal to be a believer, or just in situations where it feels impossible to share their faith, where it feels impossible to follow Christ. Let's remember that this morning. Father God, we thank you that you're with us. We thank you that you lead us and you guide us, that you are our fortress and our strength, and our very present help in time of need. And so we first off confess to you that we are in a time of need every moment of every day. We need you. And so we cry out to you, holding on to your promises, that as we draw near to you, you draw near to us. That as we abide in you, we bear much fruit. That as your Spirit dwells within us, you produce fruit in our lives. And we thank you for that, and we praise you for that. And so, Father, we pray that as we are gathered here today with other believers, as we are gathered today under the banner of Christ, united as your church, as your body, would this be a time of equipping and encouragement? May it be a time of challenge to take that next step of faith, to follow you where you are leading us. And so, Father, we trust you that you will not leave us, you will not forsake us. Wherever you call us, you go before us. You are with us. You are a rear guard. And we never have to fear because you are with us. And so we praise you for who you are this morning. We pray for those who don't know you that we would be a light in the darkness, that they would see our good works and give glory to you, that they would see our life not lived in our own power, but lived by your Spirit, and they would be drawn to you. We thank you for the ways that you provide for us. We thank you for the ways that you've called us and equipped us and called us to be a part of what you're doing. We thank you for those who give so faithfully to Hinton Alliance Church, not to build our kingdom, but to build your kingdom, to pool our resources to reach this city, this province, and the nation, and around the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we pray that we would keep our eyes focused on you. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. And so we're going to take up our offering now, and we just invite you to continue joining with us in worship.
Our idols just to see them fall, and our false gods brought us nothing at all. How foolish we have been. Forgive us for our sins, Maker. There is none like you. No one else will do. Lord, there is no other God. Lord, there is no other God. Maker, there is none like you. And on our own, we have nothing but shame. Grace, we all can stand again. How foolish we have been. Forgive us for our sins, Maker. There is none like you, Savior. No one else will do. Lord, there is no other God. Lord, there is no other God. Maker, there is none like you. Yeah.
feel free to stand with us.
Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other.
And if our God is with us, then who could stand against us? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then who could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand again? What could stand again? What could stand again?
Lord, we believe that from the bottom of our hearts.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you,
Lord, we trust you.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore
restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise.
We pour out our praise.
It's your breath.
We pour out a praise into your breath. In our- God of gods and Lord of lords, you are the compassionate one, you are slow to anger, you are forgiving, you are holy and you are just and you are compassionate. And we worship you this morning, we lift you high, we honor and glorify you above all the nations, above all the kingdoms, above all the fears and worries and concerns of life. We lift you high and we honor and worship your name. And we give you praise alone, for you alone are worthy. You alone, O God. Thank you, Jesus. We honor you this morning. O Father, be among us. We expect your presence here. We long for you to move among us, to touch our hearts, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and to fill us fresh with the Spirit of God, that we might live for you and worship you using your breath as we just sung. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. And we're just going to enter into our message this morning, but we're going to start with a video. And we do these videos so that the kids can kind of get a grasp or a handle on what is happening as we go through our Revisiting Sunday School series. And this morning, our topic, our person of interest, is a fellow by the name of Jacob. And I know I've really enjoyed studying Jacob's life, and I know that today you will be blessed and encouraged through his life, and you will find strength from God like he did. And so we're going to do this, and once the video is done, then our kids can be dismissed to their time together up to the age of kindergarten. Are welcome to go, and you can go out those back doors and just down the hallway, and you'll find the classrooms that they'll be in. Okay?
God's story, Jacob and Esau. So part of God's story is about twin brothers, and it begins like this. Once, there were twins named Jacob and Esau, and they didn't get along. They actually started fighting before they were born. Then during birth, Esau came out first, but Jacob was holding on to his heel. That's not normal. And they even look different. The Bible says Esau's body was covered in so much red hair, it was almost like he had clothes on. Jacob's skin was smooth. Well, they got even more different as they grew up. Esau hunted animals and spent time outside. Their dad, Isaac, was a big meat eater, so Esau was his favorite. Jacob, on the other hand, was a quiet guy who liked to stay indoors. Their mom, Rebecca, liked Jacob the best. The Bible doesn't talk much about Jacob and Esau as kids, but we do know Esau was lucky to be the oldest because he had what's called a birthright. That meant Esau would be in charge of their family, including all their money, land, and stuff. Jacob would probably have to work for his brother Esau, and their dad Isaac would give Esau a blessing, which means Isaac would ask God to take care of his oldest son Esau in an extra special way. Well, you probably think Esau was pretty excited about this, but he wasn't. In fact, one day he gave it up. He'd just returned from a hunting trip. Since he was out killing animals all day, he didn't have time to eat. He came home starving. Jacob was making stew, so Esau said, "Quick, give me some of that stew. I'm very hungry." Now, Jacob was a little sneaky, so he didn't just share the stew with his hungry brother, which would have been nice. Instead, he said, "First, sell me your birthright." And guess what? Esau said yes. It's a little like paying $1 million for a bowl of mushy soup. We don't know why Esau did that, but the Bible says he didn't care about the birthright. But later, when Isaac was really old and about to die, he wanted to ask God to take special care of his firstborn Esau. So he told Esau to go hunting and make him some tasty food, maybe for the last time. Now, Esau wanted the birthright, so he left right away to hunt. Meanwhile, Rebecca had heard Isaac and Esau talking, and remember, Jacob was her favorite. She wanted him to get the blessing. So she did something really sneaky. She told Jacob, "I will prepare tasty food for your father. You take it to your father to eat, then he'll give you his blessing before he dies." See, Isaac was blind. She was telling Jacob to pretend he was Esau. But there was a slight problem with her plan. First off, Esau was hairy. So if Isaac touched Jacob's smooth skin, he would know the truth. The Bible says Esau had a certain smell too, which might be a polite way of saying he stunk. I mean, imagine how smelly a guy would be if he was always sweating and getting dead animal blood stuck on his clothes and matted in his hairy skin. And this was before deodorant. So even though Isaac was blind, he might smell Jacob or touch his smooth arm and know the truth. Well, Rebecca was sneaky like Jacob. She told Jacob to put sheepskin on his arms and wear some of Esau's smelly clothes. Now Isaac would never know. And even though Isaac wondered why the voice sounded like Jacob, guess what? The trick worked. Jacob got the blessing. Now Esau would have to work for him. As you might imagine, Esau was furious. In fact, Rebecca had to help Jacob run away so Esau wouldn't kill him. What's really crazy about this story is Jacob messed up big time. But he really did get God's blessing. Esau even forgave him later. We don't know why God let this happen, but the truth is, we all mess up sometimes. And God still wants us to be part of his story. And that's the story of Jacob and Esau. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version. Jacob and Esau were twins. They were different. Jacob tricked Esau. Esau sold his birthright for stew. Later, Esau wanted his blessing. Rebekah helped Jacob trick his dad, Isaac. Jacob got Esau's blessing. Esau was furious. Jacob ran away, but God still blessed him. And that's a part of God's story.
Oh, there's just no way to tell it that good, is there? Jacob, what a scoundrel he was. You know, 30 times in the scripture, God is proud to be called the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But what? Did you hear that? That God throughout scripture, 30 times specifically, he is making himself known as the God of Abraham, which we could understand that. We could even understand the God of Isaac. But the God of Jacob too? The scoundrel, the liar, the cheater? Really? He wants to make himself known that way for eternity? And the answer is yes. In fact, as you get to know this story, you begin to realize that always, like in Scripture, so often there are double meanings, there are figurative meanings, there are symbolic meanings to everything that's going on, especially names. Names can have many different kinds of meanings. And Abraham, we know his name was changed from Abram to Abraham, that he would be the father of many. Well, Jacob also had a name change. But why was his name changed? What was the deal there? Well, we're going to find out today. The story of Jacob is very important. And if you know what his name means, it begins to become a bit more obvious, especially after watching this cartoon. Jacob's name really means grasper. That's what it means. That, you remember the picture of him coming out and he was grasping onto Esau's heel? He's a grasper. And also it has with it this idea of deceiver. So he will do anything he can to get what he wants. That's the idea behind Jacob. Whatever it takes. You could say it in modern terms, nobody else is going to look after me, so I better look after me. That means Jacob. Okay, so that's what we're talking about here. And this could be one of the most amazing reasons why God is proud to be known as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Because Jacob has a change. He has a change in his life, but it takes him a long time to get there. Does that sound familiar? Changes do not come quickly, do they? They seem to take a long time. Now, God miraculously sometimes things can happen, boom, you're done. Say if you have a struggle with some abuse of alcohol or something, there are many testimonies where God just comes along and wipes it away. No more struggle. But most of the time, God wants us to wrestle these things to the ground with his help and look to him for strength. And this is why Jacob's story is so important to us today. It's really this boils down to this. The underlying point that comes out of the life of Jacob is this. Jacob is unworthy of God's gracious, divine blessings. Jacob is unworthy of God's gracious, divine blessings. Now, just say that out loud with me. Jacob is unworthy of God's gracious, divine blessings. Now, instead of saying Jacob, I just want you to put your own name there. And just say, I am unworthy of God's gracious, divine blessings. Amen? Thus endeth the sermon today. Are you kidding me? No way, man. Okay, God had promised, now you saw the picture of him coming out of the womb, and you saw that funny picture of they were fighting inside of Rebekah's womb. Do you remember that picture? Yeah. All right, so what was going on there? Rebekah got worried, as most moms would. Something's not right in here, right? And so she sought the Lord. She said, God, what is going on inside my womb? Here's what God says. Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you will be separated. One people will be stronger than the other, and the older will serve the younger. So God told her and gave her a message, and perhaps this was why Rebecca was so conniving and scheming to make sure that what God said took place. Ever felt like that sometimes? You get a little promise from God, and so what do? You rush ahead and you take things into your own hands, and you make a complete mess, usually, because you refuse to wait. We are impatient, and Jacob, just like us, very impatient. He wanted it all now. And so by the time they're 15 or mid-teens, they're out in the field, and Jacob hatches a scheme to take away his brother's birthright over a pot of stew. Now, Esau, you know, he was a pretty easy target as well. But that birthright was so important because what it would mean is it would turn things upside down. So Esau would then be serving the younger, the older serving the young, just like the prophecy had said. But was that the way God wanted it to happen? Do you think God was cheering on Jacob? Go ahead, do a little deception. Go ahead, take advantage of your brother. Do you think that was what God was wanting? No. So Esau comes in from the hunt, he's starving, and so he consumes the stew, but not until after he takes a vow and he gives away his birthright. And this is such a sad thing, a sad state of affairs for Esau. And the scriptures do say this in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 16, "See to it that none of you become like Esau." Why? Because, it says, he was immoral and godless and sold his birthright for a single meal. So God had a warning even in Esau. Don't be like him. Don't be so consumed with what's right in front of you, so consumed with what's only there. We see only a short window. We never look past at the consequences. Just right now, we live in the moment. He said, don't be so consumed by this. It is godless to live that way. And he did not appreciate his birthright and so sold it for a pot of stew. And we are warned in Scripture not to be like Esau. Later on, as you saw in the cartoon, Esau wanted his blessing. He did what any older son would do. He did what his dad asked and went off and did what he was told in order to gain his father's blessing. But guess what? It was too late. He had already sold it anyway. And so the two brothers were already fighting in the womb, and they never stopped fighting till late in the story. All right, so then, of course, we see what happens, and Esau is furious, and he is breathing murderous threats against his brother Jacob for stealing his blessing. So conniving. Do you think God was in that? Think God was in heaven going, yeah, I really like what's happening here because I did prophesy that the younger one would rule over the older one. So I guess this will have to do. Do you think that's how God thinks? Are you kidding me? No, it's not. Jacob was impatient. Jacob could have had what God wanted him to have if he'd have just waited. And of course, his mother Rebecca is just as guilty for being such a schemer with him. Jacob came by it honestly, obviously. And he goes in there, and he puts on the goat skin to trick his father, and puts on the clothes so the smell was the same. And there you have the trickster stealing the blessing of God. Well, of course, he had to run away. Right? He couldn't stay around. It's weird to me, this story does such a twist. It would make a great movie, actually. It is such a twist in the plot. Because everything he just did, everything he just tried to accomplish by deceiving his father Esau, or Isaac, rather, by trying to get that blessing that was Esau's. Everything he accomplished, the inheritance was his, the blessing was his, the leadership in the family was his, but then what's the first thing he has to do? Run. And he runs away with how much of all that? Nothing. In fact, the Bible even says all he had was the clothes he had on his back and the staff that was in his hand. And he runs. And he gets out into the desert. And this is the first time God literally comes to him and Jacob encounters the living God. If you want to follow along, you can in Genesis 28. If you want to look there, Genesis chapter 28. We're going to be skipping along through the story because we want to get to the part where Jacob changes. So Genesis 28, starting at verse 11. When Jacob reached a certain place, I'll just wait a second till you all find it. Genesis 28. If you have trouble finding things in the Bible, always know there's a table of contents there, and you can look there and find it. Genesis just happens to be the very first book of the Bible. Divided into chapters and verses, chapter 28, starting at verse 11. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. So here he is, running like crazy. He's exhausted. He's weary. He's thought he had the world by the tail when suddenly now he has nothing, absolutely nothing. And just to prove a point, the scriptures tell us what happened. He took a stone and he put it under his head and he lay down to sleep. You got to be pretty poor to use stones for pillows. Would you not agree? And lie down in the dust. Lie down in the dust. And he fell asleep. He was so exhausted. But God came to him in a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with the top reaching up into heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord. And this is what the Lord said to Jacob. I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Is that not a solid promise? Here it is. The promise again is coming to him. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth. Very good, God. Here he is lying on a rock, sleeping in the dust. And your descendants will be like the dust of the earth. And you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. Now remember, this Sunday school term, this Sunday school summer, we started with the blessing that came after Adam and Eve sinned. Remember that blessing? Where he cursed the serpent, but he said, I will send another. I will send someone to make this right. And so this now is the promise going forward, that God is going to do that through Jacob, of all people, the deceiver. And he says, I am with you. I will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Is this promise got anything to do with Jacob, other than he is the recipient? Are you kidding? He didn't say, okay, Jacob, listen, I know you're a scoundrel, a dirty, rotten liar, and a deceiver, and you take advantage of people. I know you're like that, but I'm going to bless you anyway. No, that's not what's here. What's here is God is thinking big picture. He's saying, I am going to bless you, and all the nations, including Canada in 2021, all the nations, including Afghanistan in 2021, all the nations will be blessed through you. How is that going to happen? Well, later we know the rest of the story, don't we? We know who the blessing comes through. Who is it? Jesus. But he promises this to Jacob. Now, the story, again, this is so much like we are. God tells us these beautiful, awesome, wonderful promises. He fills us with his will, his knowledge of what he's going to do, what he's going to accomplish, because he says he's going to do it, not because of who we are. And what's the next thing that Jacob does? He turns it around, and he makes it all about himself. Listen to what happens. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep, and he thought, surely God was here, and I was not aware of it. That could definitely be the theme of Jacob's life. God was there, but Jacob didn't have a clue. Does that sound familiar to us? God is here. He is with you. He is walking through life with you. He is there no matter who you are. And most often, we are completely unaware of his presence. He makes astounding promises that he will be with us. He will be in us. One of the names of Jesus is Emmanuel. What does that mean? God with us. He is with us. He is in us. He is around us. He is before us. He is behind us. He is beside us. He is there no matter what you're going through. He is there. Do you believe it? Do you know it? Or are you like Jacob? You're unaware. You're trying to solve the problems the way you want to solve the problems. You're trying to deal with the difficulties the way you think they should be solved and dealt with. You want to handle the situation the way you think it should be handled. When all along God is there, he's trying to nudge you. Hey, like the book of Revelation says, he's standing at the door, knocking. He's knocking. He wants you to notice him. He is there. Do you believe it? Beloved, do you believe it? But the problem was that when he finally became aware of God's presence, what happened? It says right here, he was filled with fear. Instead of peace that passes understanding, instead of joy over being promised all these amazing promises, instead of lightheartedness, what happens to him? He becomes afraid. And so what does he do out of that fear? Oh my goodness, look what he does. How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, the gate of heaven. Whatever, Jacob. You're such a bonehead. All right, Jacob took the stone that he had placed under his head, and he set it up as a pillar, and he poured oil on the top of it. He made it sacred. It's a rock, Jacob. It's a rock. It's a piece of dust that over years has been combined together. And he pours oil on it, and he makes it this sacred moment. And then he makes a vow. Listen to his vow. Listen to how many times he refers to God in his vow. This is what it said. First of all, he says, if God will be with me. What? You just had an amazing dream. You just went through all this weird stuff to try and make it real for yourself. And then the first thing he says is, if, does that not sound like the Jacob inside of each of us? If God is really here, if God is really love, if God really wants me to be this or do that or go there, if God, and we get all iffy about God, right? You know what that sounds like? If I say to my wife, if you love me, what am I looking for? I'm looking for some control. I'm saying, if you love me, you'll do this for me, right? I'm actually trying to control her. She doesn't respond very well to that. I just want you to know right now, that vocabulary left my mouth a long time ago. Okay? If God will be with me. Wow. It's hard to actually put into words how dumb that is. But you think about ourselves. No wonder God calls us sheep, right? Because sheep are, they're okay. But they are not the smartest animal in the tool shed. Right? All right, let's keep going. Where are we at? I forget now. Verse 20. God will be with, count how many times, me, and will watch over me on this journey I am taking, and will give me food to eat, clothes to wear, so that I return safely to my father's house. Then the Lord will be my God. If then, If God will do this, then this will happen. If God will answer this prayer, then I'll serve him. If God will take me here or give me this woman or give me this thing or give me this job, then I will serve him. Does that not sound familiar to you? Do we not bargain with God all the time? If you'll just give me this one thing, that's all I'm asking God. Just give me this one thing, and then I'll serve you. And we bargain with him as if somehow he's going to be convinced by your, what you have. You've all seen the movies where the bad guy says, you got nothing to bargain with, right? You got nothing to bargain with. If, then, me, my, I, who's the focus of all of this? Jacob. He's a selfish manipulator. I better be careful because, you know what? So am I. I'm also a selfish manipulator. If I can get my way, I will. Jacob is just like us. And you know, if we don't take stock, if we don't stop our running and our searching and our striving and our conniving and our using our wisdom, quote unquote, even the scripture says the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of man. If there is such a thing as foolishness in God, it's wiser than your wisdom. Instead of being filled with peace, instead of feeling, you know, vision, look what's going to happen. What is God going to do? How is this going to open up? It's going to be amazing. He just takes off. He leaves that spot. All right, let's move on. In chapter 29, I'm not going to read the whole chapter, obviously, but Jacob meets his match. I love this part of the story. Uncle Laban is even more of a conniving schemer than Jacob, if you can imagine that. I can imagine, you know, Uncle Laban and Mama Rebecca, right? Can you imagine that household? Everybody trying to outdo the other? Talk about sibling rivalry. Anyway, he shows up at Uncle Laban's house. And who does he meet? The love of his life. Whoa. Well, he shows up there. He shows off there for Rachel. He shows up at a well, just so you know, right? Everybody's waiting for all the sheep to come. Everybody's standing around. So Jacob says, hey, you guys happen to know my Uncle Laban? Yeah. In fact, his daughter and his sheep are coming up. And he looks, he sees her, he goes, hey, I'll take care of the opening of the well. And he lifts the whole stone off by himself. Hey, what do you think? He's showing off. He's strutting like a peacock. I think he had the thing, you know, that heart thing for Rachel. And really, that's one of the reasons why he went there, was to find a wife. And I think he thinks he found it. Found her. Wow. So Jacob decides to stick around for a month. And he stays for a whole month. Imagine the joy, hey? Showing off for Rachel, no responsibilities, just a few jobs, odd jobs that father-in-law potential gives him to do. And there he is in love. And Laban comes to him and says, hey, you've been here a month. You know, you're my family, so I won't say you're a moocher. But how about we start, you know, you become my servant. I'll pay you. And you become working for me. So Jacob stays. And he says, well, I'll tell you what, I'll do that. And the wages will be set at 7 years dowry so that I can have Rachel as my beautiful bride. And Uncle Laban goes, that is a pretty good deal. And so, 7 years go by. And in fact, it even says that they were so, it seemed like nothing to Jacob because he was so in love. Hey, he's so in love with Rachel. It's a beautiful love story. He finishes the 7 year. He comes to Uncle Laban. He says, Laban, now's the time. Bring me my bride. And so Laban says, yep, we're going to do it. And so he throws a huge party. Right? Some of you know this story. I can see it on your faces. Uncle Laban is a scoundrel. You see, Rachel had an older sister who owned the birthright because there were no sons. None that were told about, anyway. And even later, Laban claims that he held on to the birthright because of what he does here. So what does he do? Remember now, it's not like modern times. When the sun goes down, it's dark, right? So the sun goes down, and Uncle Laban, I don't know how he got Rachel to agree to this, he takes Leah, he dresses her in all the garb, so you can't see her, and it's dark anyway, and he gives her to Jacob, pretending it's Rachel. Can you imagine? In the morning, when he wakes up, who is beside him? The wrong woman! Well, he's furious! Well, doesn't that just sound like a few comeuppance, eh? Don't you just sort of get what you deserve sometimes, Jacob? You dirty, rotten scoundrel. You were out-scoundreled by your dirty, rotten uncle. You know, the scriptures has a saying for that. In the world, outside of God, it says it's like dog eat dog. Doesn't that sound like that? Whatever I can get to my advantage. You see, Laban had a scheme in mind. He saw how much Jacob loved Rachel. And so he thought, this guy works hard, 7 years, that's great, it's a good price. But if I could get another 7 out of him, even better. And so he switches the bride at night. And so to appease Jacob, he says, okay, listen. You fulfill your weekly duty towards Leah. In other words, you make her your wife. And at the end of that time, I'll give you Rachel, but you have to promise another 7 years of labor. And so Jacob is so in love, he says, nope, I'm leaving. No way, he wants Rachel. And so he works another 7 years, 14 years. She must have been quite a stunning woman. 14 years. Now all the men here, just turn to your wives if they're around you and say, I would work 14 years for you. Sure thing, sweetie. Come on now. You hear what I'm saying? All right. So, the stage is set. He marries Rachel. He works another 7 years. I'll tell you what, though. Two sisters in the same household. One has deceived the husband to gain marriage. The other has been abused by the deception. Do you think things went well? Do you think that household was just filled with peace and awesomeness? What a blissful situation. No. In fact, it was even worse, because the scripture even clearly says Jacob loved Rachel more than he loved Leah. Oh boy. Right? Now there's tension. But the problem was, Leah was fertile myrtle. Every time they got together, popping out babies. Rachel, barren. Rachel was barren. So what happened? Rachel starts to get very feisty. And the two of them go at each other, and they start stealing stuff, and they start going crazy about things, and the two start fighting, and, well, you know, great-grandma Sarah gave Abraham a servant. Maybe I'll give you this servant and you can have my kids. And that didn't go very well either. You see, when you start to take things in your own hands, folks, it's a clear lesson. Number one, there's always somebody more conniving and more deceptive than you. There's always somebody. Somebody say amen. There's always somebody. Even though you think you don't have that problem, you do. The second thing is not only is there someone more conniving than you, it creates a complete mess of things. That's what happens when you try to do your own thing. Well, eventually, Jacob, you know, God said he was going to bless Jacob. So he did. He blessed Jacob, and Jacob was getting wealthier and wealthier. And Laban was getting poorer and poorer. So at one point, it was so tense between Laban and Jacob. It says in the scripture that Laban tried to change the wages of Jacob 10 times. So it was tense at home, and it was tense with the father-in-law. And you can imagine that Jacob loved being a shepherd 3 miles away from his home and from his uncle. One day, God visits him and says, Jacob, I want you to return to your homeland. Oh, that's such good news. So he leaves behind Uncle Laban, doesn't tell him what he's doing, and he takes all the kids, grandkids. Imagine if your grandkids suddenly just disappeared and your daughters gone. And he didn't find out for 3 days, the scripture said, because Jacob was very sneaky about it. And he's good at that. And so it says after 3 days he finds out, so it took him 7 days to catch up. And of course, Laban was ready to kill his son-in-law because he said, you've taken my family and kidnapped them like captives of war. So he was ready to kill him, but God stood in the way and said, don't you touch a hair of his head. And so Laban obeyed because he was, you know, he worshiped many gods, and if God, one God says do that, he better do that. And so he spared Jacob's life, and the two made peace before he left and kissed his grandkids and daughters goodbye. But then, each step of the way, the Bible says it was over 400 miles away. So 400 miles, every step after he got away from Laban, guess who was on his mind? He's going home. Who's there? Esau. And with each step, imagine the stress level. Hey? Each step, stress level going up, going up, and going up, and going up. Anybody, that sound familiar to anybody? Anybody stressed out like almost to the max here in our culture, in our time? Aren't people stressed? Because you can't figure out how am I going to solve this problem. Where is God in all this stress? God had even told him to go home. He'd already promised, I'll be with you and no one will harm you and I'll watch over you and I'll protect you. He had made all those promises, but Jacob wasn't interested in what God had to say. Jacob was interested in saving his own bacon. And so you know what he did? Oh my goodness, this is so dumb. All right, so, I mean, this part's actually kind of cool. He sends, like he's got tons and tons of sheep and cattle and all the rest of it. He sends a huge gift ahead of him to meet Esau, right? Good plan. If I can maybe give him a whole lot of stuff, that'll help soften the blow of my rival. Well, the report comes back to him that the people who brought the gift, you know, thank you very much, but Esau is coming with 400 men. Okay, now it's serious. So what does he do? He divides his family in half. And he sends his kids and his children away first with all the rest of the stuff, and then he sends a second camp of his wives. And they separate. He tells them all how to do it, to march at a certain pace so that they're separated from each other. Just in case Esau kills this group has a chance to escape. And then you know where Jacob went? He stayed behind. He's a coward. He stayed behind. He put his kids and his wives and everything he had out there as fodder for angry Esau. And he stayed behind. But, this is the good news. He was alone, and he was by himself, and guess who showed up? God did. God showed up. You know, when he was alone before, remember he took the pillow, a stone, he was alone by himself. Remember that story? God spoke to him because he had nothing to offer. He had no bargaining chips. He thought he did, but he had nothing to offer, really. God just said, I'm going to bless you. And God was true to himself. He wasn't true to Jacob's deception. He was true to himself, true to his word. God will always, always, always be faithful to his word. Did you hear that? Everything that comes from the mouth of God, he will be true to it. You can take it to the bank. You can count on it. You can stand on it. In this morning we said, on Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Amen. So Jacob, in chapter 32 now, we get to chapter 32, starting at verse 24. I'll give you a second to catch up because this is a really important part. I don't want to rush past this. This is where Jacob literally changes. All right, he literally changes. In fact, his name is changed. All right, here we go. Genesis 32. So Jacob was left alone. I love that. You know, folks, in our busy, crazy pace that we live, being alone is actually an okay place. It's an okay place. Because when you're alone, when you don't have any distractions, and I'm talking alone, alone, get your phone away from you for a second, alone, that's when God can meet you. Did you hear that? If you feel like your life is completely out of control, if you feel like you're just running, 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 if you feel like you've bargained your way and you've bargained away your last chip and you got nothing left in the tank, if you're at the bottom looking up, if you're below the bottom looking up, the music will sound. No, I'm just kidding. Your bottom looking up. You're looking up. And you're alone. God is there. He's there. And if you feel desperate, if you feel alone, if you feel like if I died tomorrow, no one would care, you're wrong. Because God is there. And when Jacob is alone, it says, a man came to him and wrestled with him until daybreak. Notice who does the wrestling. Who does the wrestling? The man comes. The man comes to wrestle. God is, he is coming towards you. He is seeking you out. He is looking to wrestle you to the ground so that he can pin you finally. And you have to confess, I got no chips. I'm done, and I am undone. I have told so many lies, I don't even know what's the truth anymore. I have done so many desperate, stupid things in my life, I can't even recount them all anymore. I have abandoned, I have hurt, I have taken advantage of people. My whole life, I have a trail of broken relationships behind me. I'm at the end. Then a man comes. A man comes and he wrestles with you. You know, you can't wrestle unless you're together. You ever watch the Olympic wrestling? It's almost embarrassing how close they are together, hey? God comes and he wrestles with Jacob. And they wrestle all night long, it says. Look what happens. And they wrestled together till daybreak. You know, our wrestling with God, our giving up of our pride, our giving up of our stubborn ways, our giving up of who we are, our surrender to God takes time and energy. He was exhausted by the morning, but he would not stop because his pride was so strong. And folks, our pride is exactly the same. It will get in the way of what God wants to accomplish. He wants to bless you. Hallelujah. Somebody give the Lord a clap. He wants to bless you. And he will wrestle you to the ground until you finally admit he is the king and not you. Not you. There he is. Wrestling till daybreak. Now look at how strong he is. Look at how strong Jacob is. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, this man is God. He could not overpower him. Isn't that interesting? You think he was God, he could do whatever he wanted. But God is gracious. And you know what? He gives you the freedom to choose to stop wrestling with him. And he will wrestle you until you admit he wins. And don't forget he's God. So he has a few other tricks up his sleeve. More tricks than Jacob does. So what happens next? They're wrestling. And finally, the man reaches over and touches Jacob's hip. He touches his hip. What happened then? It was wrenched from its socket. And guess what he had to do? He had to quit. But did he? Something happened here. You know, this is really interesting. The hip is the strongest muscle you have in your body. Do you think it's by accident he reached over and touched his hip? Just any place will do. No, he touched his hip. Why? Why? Remember the symbolic meaning of things. Because it's the strongest part of you, and he had to touch it. He had to touch it and knock it out of socket before Jacob finally stopped wrestling. And now, the wrestling had stopped, but the grasping hadn't stopped, if you notice. What happened? All right, so the man said, "Let me go, for it's daybreak. We've been doing this too long." And Jacob says, "I will not let you go until you bless me." So he'd stopped wrestling, but he hadn't stopped grasping. Actually, this time, it's the first time in Jacob's life that he is grasping at the right heel. He is grasping, that is, at the proper heel. He is grasping for God. He is holding on to God because now he knows who he's wrestling in. I think before he didn't know. Now he knows. It's God. It's the Lord himself that he's been wrestling. And the picture couldn't be more beautiful. He finally stops grasping at his own strength, at his own ideas, at his own will. He submits it to God. He submits himself to God. He submits himself to God. And he grasps only him. I was reminded of that story in the New Testament, that woman who was bleeding so much. She tried all the doctors. All her wealth was gone. And what did she do? All she wanted to do was reach out and grasp the robe of Jesus and find healing. That kind of grasping, folks, that kind of grasping is A-okay. Because the way the Lord responds is so beautiful. "I won't let you go until you bless me." Now, again, Jacob is a little lost, okay? And he's got a sore hip, so I'll give him some grace. God has already said how many times I'm going to bless you. How many? At least 3. Maybe even more that we're not even known, really. He's already told him. But Jacob is so determined at this point. He can't go forward unless he has God's blessing. Folks, this is desperate living. This is the times we live in. This is who we are. We are Jacob. We need God more than we think we do. And we need to just grasp him and hang on to him with everything we have. Because the other stuff we've been grasping for, it's only led to trouble and dismay and discouragement and brokenness. Sometimes God, in his healing, his mercy, he breaks us so that he can heal us. Have you heard that kind of expression before? Sometimes in his mercy, he will do what it takes to get you to understand you cannot live by your own bootstraps. You must depend on him. And Jacob is right there. And so what does the man say? What's the question? "What is your name? Who are you? What are you all about?" And Jacob willingly coughs up, "Jacob, I'm a deceiver. I'm a grasper. I'm the kind of person who'll do whatever it takes to get my own way, to put me on the top and everybody else at the bottom. I'm a coward." That's what he was saying when he said his name out. "I'm confessing I am a weak, weak man." And then God says those beautiful words. Then the man said, "Your name is no longer Jacob. Your name is no longer Jacob. Instead, I will give but Israel." So he gives them the name Israel, which means you've struggled with God and men and you've overcome. You have become victorious in me, through me. You finally believe the promise I gave you when your head was on that pillow. You finally believe that the promise I gave your mother while you were in the womb was the thing that I would accomplish, not you. You finally believe that I am the conqueror and you are the conquered. And this is what Jesus said when he was on this earth, so much similar to this. He said, listen, if you want to follow me, you must take up your cross and you must kill yourself. You must deny yourself every day and follow me. And if you do that, you will find life. Abundant life, he called it. But until you die, until your socket of your hip has been popped out by the finger of God, and oftentimes the finger of God is recognized in Scripture as the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit comes. You cannot hang on to your sin and the divine Spirit of God at the same time. Somebody is going to lose. And you don't want it to be the Spirit. You want it to be your old sinful self. It's not easy. Romans, Paul the apostle said, I want to do good, but evil is right there with me. Pride, arrogance, wanting to take control, wanting to do it your way is never far away. It's right around the corner. It's always present with us. In fact, I can't wait for heaven because it will be so amazing not to have sin at your door waiting to consume you. Won't that be amazing? Here, though, that's all we know. The New Testament says that when we come to know Jesus, we are a new creation. We get a new name. We get a new name. In fact, that name is secret. In the book of Revelation, the scriptures tell us that Jesus will give us a new name. Isn't that amazing? He will give us a new name. And that whole thing is a symbolic move on his part to say, well done. You did it. You followed me. You clung to me while you walked on this earth. Well done. Well done. Here's your new name. I've tried to figure out what that name could be. But you know, Kevin is pretty good. It means handsome one. So maybe it'll be Kevin 2.0. I'm just kidding. Let's look at the last couple of verses. The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, that's what he named it, the face of God, and he was limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites do not eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip, because the socket of Jacob's hip was touched near the tendon. The wrestler with a limp. Every time he stepped from that day forward, what do you think he remembered? His new name? Sure. His wrestling match with the Lord? Obviously. Who won? You bet. Who won? And that limp went through the rest of his life. He had to use his staff as his crutch. We were talking about this last night. If you need a crutch, if you're limping, a crutch is a really handy deal. Yep, there's one right there. I see that crutch. Hey. God says that it's in our weakness that his power is made perfect. What's your weakness? Maybe you need to boast about that a little more and a little less about your own power. Hey, boast in your weakness. You know what? I am weak at many things, and they need to become the things that show God's power in my life. They need to be the things that reveal God is with me. And Paul even says in 2 Corinthians, therefore I will boast more gladly about my weakness, because in my weakness his power is made strong. Paul went around talking about his weaknesses, not about his strengths. What a terrible resume. I don't know if we'd have hired you if all you put on there was your weaknesses. I don't know if you'd have hired me if all you put, here's my list of weaknesses, you know, 5, 6, 8, 9, 10 pages. Whoa, do we want this guy here? But you see, in the weaknesses, that's where God is present with his power. Somebody say amen. It's in our weaknesses that he is made strong. And Jacob is a perfect symbol of this truth. Another thing Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 is that God chooses the foolish things of this world to shame the wise, and God chooses the weak things of this world to shame the strong. He uses your weakness to promote his glory. That's what he does. Isn't he an amazing God? Hello? You couldn't have made this up. You could not have possibly in a million years made yourself look as bad as Jacob did. And then for God in heaven to say, oh, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He says with a smile, because Jacob is now Israel. My prince who knows how to struggle with me and overcome. That's what Israel means. To struggle with God and overcome. Do you need to overcome some things in your life? Hello? Do we all? Yes, we do. Give them to God. Stop your wrestling. Daybreak is coming. Let me go, he says. I will not let you go until you bless me. What is your name? Tell him honestly who you are. Just be real. Maybe for the first time in a long time. Be real. Be open with him. It's not like you're telling him any kind of news he doesn't know. He knows everything. Be honest with him. Give it to him. Let him have it. If you refuse, if you dig your heels in, he is going to touch your hip. He is going to do it. Because it's only when you're weakest, that's when he is made powerful. What a lesson from Jacob. Amen. Did you learn this in Sunday school? No, I mean, it was cute. It was fun. What a great story, you know, for kids to learn, right? For all you new Christians to learn. This is a great story. But if you dig a little deeper, wow, is it a powerful story. And never forget, remember at the beginning I said, replace your name with Jacob's, or Jacob's name with your name? Now at the end, you replace your name with what God did. He is your God. I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Kevin. Woo! He's my God. I cling to him. I need him every day. Ha! I feel like one of those old-time preachers. I need him more than I think I do. He wants me to draw near. He wants me close to him. He wants to touch me. He wants me to offer up my weaknesses so he can be made strong, so that the world can know that's what he does. He changes us forever and ever in the name of Christ and by the power of his Holy Spirit. That's what he does. Ha! There you go. Amen.
Well, that was a great message. Thank you, Pastor Kevin. Let's stand. We're going to close with King of Kings.
In the darkness, we were without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
To the King. the kingdom coming and to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation. You did not despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died.
Death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who come to the Father are restored.
And the church of Christ was born, and the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Thank you so much, Father, for your goodness and your grace in our lives. We proclaim your greatness. We proclaim today that you are the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. You are the only one worthy of our worship and our praise. And so we ask, Father, that you would receive the glory from our lives, that as we go out of this place, that we would go out proclaiming Jesus and Jesus alone. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. And so may we go out of this place as weak men and women walking in the power of Christ. Amen? Amen. Amen. Have a blessed week.